Welcome, welcome. Good afternoon, good evening, wherever you're tuning in from. Welcome to Medscape's Getting Social on Photoprotection. We are going to be doing a deep dive today, going throughout the gamut regarding safety, efficacy, how sunscreens work, you name it. If it's about photoprotection, we will be hitting on those subjects. Next slide, please. I'm Dr. Adam Friedman, professor and chair of dermatology at GW School of Medicine Health Sciences, and I'm joined by two wonderful friends and colleagues from across the country. First, I have Dr. Neda Albulik from USC. She's associate professor in the Department of Dermatology and director of the Skin of Color and Pigmentary Disorder Program. And joining me not too far away from Washington, D.C., Dr. Tasni Muhammad, who is staff physician at Henry Ford and Department of Dermatology. Welcome, guys. Thanks for joining.
Thanks for having us.
Thanks for having us.
All right, let's get right into it. Next slide, please. So if we're going to talk about photoprotection, and that really encompasses a spectrum of activities, not just sunscreen, but there are other measures we will discuss. We also have to consider what is it we are protecting ourselves, our patients, our loved ones from, and that really comes to the spectrum of light. And there are many different wavelengths we need to be considerate of. And that's where I'd really like to start. What you see before you are different clinically relevant wavelengths, whether you're thinking about ultraviolet radiation, visible light. And we're not really going to get into infrared, though I think, you know, near infrared is an interesting area when you start to think about maybe targeted drug activation, heating deeper tissues. We're going to push that aside for right now and really focus on the first two. So why don't we start with Dr. Muhammad talking a little bit about the relevance of these different wavelengths and how they can translate to the human condition and, of course, disease.
Yeah. So, you know, I agree that, you know, all of these wavelengths are really important for us to know about and know what their impact on the skin is. And traditionally, we always thought that, okay, we need to worry about ultraviolet radiation. And most of the UVC is really filtered out through the ozone, so we don't have to worry about it too much. But traditionally, we would think, okay, UVB is sunburns, UVA is going to be aging, and, you know, that's where we're getting inflammation in the skin from and photocarcinogenesis. And this is done through, you know, DNA damage, through CPD dimers with UVB photo rays, and then with UVA through more oxidative damage. But more recently, we've really understood the importance of the impact of visible light on the skin. And so visible light is a pretty broad wavelength, but we know that most of the clinical effect is more in the blue-violet range. And we know that it does cause oxidative damage to the skin, and it's more commonly manifested in pigmentation in darker skin tones.
Now, well covered. And I think, you know, when we talk about it with our patients and even trying to argue with our family members why they should be protecting themselves, not just from ultraviolet radiation, but even from visible light, whether it be in a room, whether it be from a device, I think all these things have to consider. And putting into the clinical context of what these things can do, I often say B is for burning. So that's something to consider. UVA, because it goes a little bit deeper, we consider about accelerated skin aging and all the things we don't want to have happen as we get older. I think that often scares people more than the prospect of skin cancer. But I agree, the visible element of, you know, true photoprotection is still somewhat new, especially even for us as dermatologists and how we talk about it. You know, out in California, Dr. Albulik, how do you talk to your patients about it? Does it even come up in your practice?
In terms of visible sunscreen or visible light effects with sunscreen?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
I actually talk about it a lot because I also have an interest in pigmentary disorders and I treat a lot of people of color, many of them who have, you know, disorders of pigmentation. So, you know, the first thing is even getting people to recognize they need sunscreen. And a lot of these pigmentary conditions are affected by ultraviolet and visible light, as Dr. Muhammad explained. You know, traditionally, what we've learned is that, you know, visible light, we need to block with certain molecules. So these are things like iron oxide mixed with, you know, titanium dioxide or zinc oxide. And so a lot of times people don't like that cast that sometimes can come with those mineral sunscreens. So I really talked to them about, you know, not just using mineral sunscreens, but also finding tinted mineral sunscreens that blend in with their skin more so that they feel it's cosmetically elegant, but still provides them the protection they need. And here where it's sunny pretty much year round, you know, I pretty much have to get them to incorporate it in their lifestyle every day. It's not just something that they can use here and there. And so it's really about getting them to understand this, broadening this spectrum, what's going to adequately protect them, and then finding what provides that in a vehicle that they like.
No, well said. And, you know, not to give too much of a spoiler here, but we just recently conducted a study, a survey study, asking dermatologists, do they talk to their patients about visible light? And I was shocked that the majority do. I really did not think that would be the case. But you hit on such a huge point, which is it's usually in the context of pigmentary disorders. And mm-hmm. so maybe it's really, we have to broaden our thinking. It's not just about pigmentary disorders, but as was mentioned, it also can be the source of oxidative stress, free radical generation that can cause injury to multiple levels of the skin. All right, next slide, please. All right, let's get into the nitty gritty of what makes up a ultraviolet filter, a sunscreen ingredient. And, you know, in the U.S., we have 17 UV filters that are approved by the U.S. Two of them are physical or inorganic filters, and the remaining are what are called chemical or organic filters. This has been the same number for probably a bit too long, but I think it's important to talk about what we have and how to distinguish them, how to think about them. Dr. Mohammed, why don't we start with you in talking about the physical UV filters and what their goals are and how they function?
Yeah. So right now we have the two physical UV filters. So we have zinc oxide and titanium dioxide. And those, so these are going to function on the skin by scattering light, reflecting, and absorbing UV light. The thing with these particles is that they're pretty large particles. And so when you think of, you know, the traditional sunscreen ad with someone with that white pasty kind of film on their face, that's a zinc oxide or titanium dioxide sunscreen. And a lot of times these are used together. But obviously, most people don't want to have that white chalky appearance. So what the sunscreen companies will actually do is they take those large particles and they break them down into nanoparticles. And so when you apply those nano-sized particles to your skin, it actually improves the appearance of the sunscreen on your skin. But when you do that, you lose that coverage from UVB, UVA, and visible light, because with visible light, you need to have something that's opaque on the skin. So once you make those nano-sized particles, you're shifting your coverage to UVB, and the shorter wavelength UVAs. And so as Dr. Albalik mentioned, a lot of times what you can do to help get that visible light coverage is adding in iron oxides, which can be more cosmetically acceptable and give you a better color match that you can match to your shade.
I'm so happy you brought up nanoparticles. You know, I'm a nano enthusiast, so that's my conflict of interest right here. And you hit on something huge there, which is, you're right, shrinking the particle down below the spectrum of visible light, which will then in turn make them invisible, then negates their ability to scatter visible light. And so while you're gaining the benefit of adherence, being able to apply these more readily and not being worried about, you know, the kabuki makeup appearance, you lose that added benefit. So then having to add something else in to give you that full spectrum coverage is so important. Now, it was easy for you to, there are two mineral, two physical UV filters. You know, I'm not going to expect Dr. Albalik to, you know, rattle off all the chemical filters. That'd be really mean. We're friends, right? But yeah. You talk a little about how they work and where you see them fitting in.
Yeah, exactly. Well, thank you for not making me remember all 15. So, you know, the chemical sunscreens are ones that I think people are more, you know, initially used to be more commonly used to hearing about. Nowadays, you hear a lot of conversation about the mineral ones too. But chemical sunscreens basically have these filters in them, which have names like avobenzone and oxybenzone and octareolene and a few others we'll talk about later. And so they basically absorb the wavelengths from the sun. So instead of scattering and reflecting the way that the physical blockers are working, they're absorbing the wavelength. And so that's why usually with chemical sunscreens, you want to put them on about 15 minutes or so before going outside, because you want to have time for it to be absorbed in your skin so that when that UV light is hitting you, you know, the sunscreen will absorb those UV rays and then protect you from the effects of them in your skin. Most of the sunscreens are going to provide UVB coverage and some UVA coverage. So there's a lot of terminology nowadays on bottles, say broad spectrum. That means you're getting UVA and some UVA. UVB is basically a shorter wavelength. So it's about 290 to 320 nanometers, whereas the UVA is a longer wavelength. And so what we're finding is that that longer UVA wavelength also can affect some of those pigmentary conditions we were talking about. And so with the chemical sunscreens, we never get full protection from the UVA spectrum. So they also, you know, tend to, because they don't have that chalky consistency, some people like them because they tend to blend into the skin nicely. For a lot of my patients of color, that tends to be a lot of times their preference are the chemical sunscreens. But there are some, you know, other individuals who don't like the idea of chemical sunscreens because of some potential of systemic absorption in the bloodstream or potential effects on the environment, which we'll talk about later. And so, and on children, for example, we usually recommend only the physical or mineral sunscreens. So I think they definitely share, they're a large percentage of the sunscreens on the market, and they can be very effective for some of those wavelengths that we talked about. But, you know, it's a personal preference as well for, you know, adults in terms of which one that they prefer to use.
No, well said. And in my opinion, I think a combination of both is ideal. And, you know, thinking about the physical UV filters, often you can identify those sunscreens when they say ultrafine or microfine. And very often these commercially available products, it's more in the micro particle range, you know, millionth versus the billionth of a meter. Is that really that important? Hard to say. But that really leads us into our next slide. You already start to hit on some of the language and lexicon that's on the bottle. And this has been updated over time. The most recent edition within, you know, a little over last decade. But this is, I think, the most important thing to talk to patients about, talked about, you know, with our family and friends, what to look for. So first and foremost, we'll start on the back. And that upper part, just below drug facts, is the list of UV filters. My opinion is more is better. And I'll tell you why. First and foremost, there is data showing that when you combine filters together, it's not an additive effect. It's not like an SPF of 7, an SPF 5 gives you a 12. There's actually a synergistic effect that gives you a higher protective capacity. This is research that's been done over the years. The other thing is there is some concern, more from just a practical standpoint, that with some of these ingredients, it could be a little irritating. If you have more things in there, you actually can get away with lower concentrations of them. So I think there's some pragmatic things that relate to how many active ingredients are in there. But when it really comes down to it, it's on the front of the bottle. The key things are broad spectrum, which means it covers that UVA and UVB you guys just heard about. SPF 15 or higher, because anything below 15 means it cannot say that it'll protect against skin cancer and all the other fun things that come with unrestricted UV exposure. I tend to recommend a 30 or higher, but 15 or higher is kind of the current dogma. And then water resistant, it could be either 40 or 80 minutes. I say, why would you, you know, undercut yourself, go for the 80 every time? But it's those basic things that I tell all my patients, I imagine you guys tell your patients as well, to look for on the bottle to make sure they're paying and buying and taking home the right thing. Next slide, please. So that begs the question, what is the best sunscreen? And feel free, either one of you guys, to jump in. What is the difficult, you know, most complex answer you can come up with that for that question?
Well, I mean, the easiest answer I can tell you that we often will say, you know, is the best sunscreen is the one you'll use, right?
So ding, ding. What do we have for Johnny? Yeah, exactly. Sorry.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think, you know, people, I think one of the biggest things is forming the habit of making sun protection a part of your life. And whatever product you feel is one that feels good on your skin, that you're happy with, that you're comfortable with, that you're actually going to use is number one. Now, with my patients that have the pigmentary disorders, like I talked about, I do try to at least convince them to pick the one that they like the most in the mineral sunscreen category. So I do try to, you know, because of their condition, push them towards that a little bit. They still have some choice, but under one category. But otherwise, you know, just if it's just for anybody and we're just talking about general protection, you know, it's really just finding a formulation that you like. And you know, I tell people too, you don't need to spend a ton of money to have a quality sunscreen. You know, I mean, there are a ton of, the market is oversaturated with sunscreens, right? From ones you can get in your drugstore to high-end ones that you can get in a doctor's office or, you know, a spa. But the reality is it all comes down to the filters that are in them and making sure that those are, you know, protecting you adequately. And, you know, it doesn't have to be an expensive bottle to do so.
Well said. Dr. Muhammad, thoughts? Agree, disagree.
I 100% agree. I think the one other thing I would add is I really like how we're starting to move towards more personalized photo protection, where we're really looking at each patient as an individual and saying, like, okay, what are we concerned about here? Are we more concerned about, you know, risk of photocarcinogenesis in someone who's been, you know, hitting the tanning beds for the last 20 years, lots of blistering sunburns, is very active with an outdoor lifestyle versus, you know, your patient who's coming in with melasma. The concerns are, you know, a little bit different. So I think really being mindful of who we're treating, why we're treating them, and then, you know, recommending our sunscreens and formulations based on that. Because I do think, you know, like Dr. Albulik mentioned, that, you know, sunscreen use is a habit, and you have to make people really embrace that as part of something they're going to do every day and something that feels comfortable. And I think it is really great that there are so many sunscreen vehicles, sunscreen formulations. So I really think that you can find the right sunscreen for each patient. I don't think anyone should have the excuse of like, oh, I just don't like sunscreen because it doesn't look nice or it doesn't feel nice, because I think we can find the right one for every person.
I think you're absolutely right. If you take a personalized approach, and one analogy that I've heard throughout the years, which I really like, is you know, kind of compared to brushing your teeth. You know, hopefully you're brushing your teeth every morning before going out and speaking to anyone. The same should be true about putting on some product, whether it be a true sunscreen or, make it easier, a facial moisturizer or a moisturizer with sunscreen. That should be as habitual as brushing your teeth or brushing your hair. And if people think about it that way, the hope would be that, you know, people will use it as often as doing those activities. Because really, as was mentioned many times over, the best sunscreen is the one you use every day, possibly multiple times a day. All right, let's get to the next slide. All right, I think this is the biggest challenge. And you know, Dr. Muhammad and I had a really good time at the most recent Academy meeting discussing these and going back and forth about some of the challenges we have to getting individuals to repeatedly use a sun protective measure such as sunscreen, given a lot of the myths and misperceptions out there. So I guess I'll pose it, Dr. Albulik, you know, what is the most common myth you hear from your patients that limits their ability to get on board with this recommendation?
Yeah, so I mean, there's a couple that I wanna bring up that just come up a lot. So, you know, the first one is people thinking that their sunscreen lasts all day. So, you know, people think they put it on the morning before they start their day, or they go to work and think it should last all day, or they get to the beach, they put it on, and then they say, "Doc, I don't know why I got burned. I did put my sunscreen on." You know, well, it doesn't last all day. And I think that that is something we're all trying to reiterate a lot, is that you have to reapply sunscreen. It really only lasts about 2 hours. And I think a lot of people either don't know or they forget that you have to reapply. So I think that is a huge thing to stress. And I try to tell them that reapplication doesn't have to be burdensome, right? So, you know, if you're someone who's out on a golf course and you don't feel like getting a bottle out and rubbing it all in, then get the spray if you prefer that, right? Like, that's fast and easy for you and you can do it, then stick with it. For a lot of my pigmentary patients that need to reapply and be really on top of it with reapplication, I talk to them about brushes. A lot of those, you know, mineral sunscreen brushes are just so quick and easy to put on, and they can do it on top of their makeup. They don't have to be touching their face again and so forth. So, you know, talking about the different formulations, I think, is helpful in the conversation for the fact that you have to reapply to have that retained efficacy of it. The other myth that comes up is people often think they only need sunscreen when they're doing outdoor activities. And I get that all the time now that I live in LA. People are like, well, when I go hiking or, you know, when I go to the beach, I wear it. And they consider that wearing regular sunscreen, and it's not. So sunscreen really has to be an important part of your life, part of your everyday. I use the toothbrushing analysis or comparison example, sorry, every time with my patients that, you know, you just want to incorporate it into your daily life, like brushing your teeth. So like after you do that, literally have your bottle of sunscreen there, put it on your face before you start the day. Because we're all getting sun, even when we're not intentionally going out to get it. So during your drive to work, you're getting it through UVA, or you're getting through the glass, even if you're in an office that has a big window and you're sitting by a window all day. So I think people underestimate how much sun exposure they're getting. Similar to that, people often think if it's cloudy or gray, they don't need sunscreen, right? It's only if it's sunny. And the reality is, no, you're getting sun all the time, even on a gray, cloudy day. So those are some of the myths that that come up a lot in my clinic that I try to dispel. The last one I'll mention is that people often think sunscreen's additive. So if they wear their makeup with an SPF 15 and something, you know, else with an SPF 15, that they're getting SPF 30. And I explain to them it doesn't add up that way, that the highest level they're getting is whatever the highest number product that they're using. So those are some of the general ones I try to go over when I meet patients.
No, those are great. I think, you know, simple conversations can really redirect how someone considers how central photoprotection is to everyday life. I think certainly a really big one is the safety. And everyone on here probably gets it at least once or twice a week, the pushback about the safety, whether it be human safety, environmental safety. So I'd love to talk a little bit about this. And, you know, Dr. Mohammed, you did such a great job distilling this into very bite-sized pieces during the Academy meeting in terms of the implications to human safety and how some of the data that has emerged over the years has maybe been a little misrepresented, or maybe some liberties have been taken, creative liberties of what they imply. Could you kind of go through some of those with us?
Yeah, definitely. So I think, you know, there have been a lot of concerns that have been raised specifically surrounding the chemical or organic sunscreen filters. And one of the reasons that this came up was there was a lot of publicity with the whole relabeling of sunscreens or categorization as grace, not grace, or needs more information to be determined whether grace or not. And grace is, it essentially means generally recognized as safe and effective. And so right now, our current physical or inorganic sunscreen filters are considered grace. But all of our other chemical filters, there are two that are considered not grace, which aren't really used in sunscreens anymore. And then the rest are in that, you know, uncertain category. And so, you know, the FDA is asking for additional testing to be performed on these sunscreens. But what does that mean kind of in a clinical context and for human safety? So at this point, we do know that sunscreen is getting absorbed when you use it in large quantities. The question is this causing any impact to our health? And a lot of the studies and a lot of the headlines that you read that say, okay, you know, these chemical sunscreens are really bad for you. They're causing effects on like your reproductive system, the endocrine system. You know, they're based on animal studies. And in these animal studies, they're using really high exposures, concentrations, and time periods. And so for one of the studies, it was actually, you know, to make it similar to use in humans, you'd have to apply 2 mg/cm², which is essentially, you know, the concentration that they use for sunscreen testing. But in real life, people are usually only applying a half to a quarter of this. So you'd have to take that much sunscreen, apply it to your entire body, and do that every day for 10 years to get these levels. So not really reflective of real life use. And a lot of the studies that have been looking at the effect of these organic sunscreens in human populations, you know, are not showing these same types of results. So I think, you know, the FDA does want additional testing, but at this time, they're very clear that we do know that there are a lot of effects that can happen from the sun, but we don't know if there's any negative impact on the skin from using sunscreen. So we should continue to use sunscreen while we're kind of in this process of getting some of this additional testing done. And then lastly, I just did want to make a point, because I know people have talked about benzene and sunscreen, and, you know, benzene is a carcinogen, and, you know, we should be worried about this. And I've had patients, you know, ask me about this as well. But I think it's important to know that this was just testing that was done randomly by a lab called Valisher. And they tested sunscreen products that were both mineral, chemical, and after sun products. And so they did detect benzene in all of these products. So it's not something that's specific to the sunscreen itself. It was probably a contaminant due to the manufacturing process. But to add another you know, wrinkle to this situation. The FDA actually did cite Fallisher more recently, saying that, you know, there were questionable testing methods that went on in this situation. So I think at this time, you know, there is nothing inherent to sunscreens that is containing benzene or these contaminants. So at this time, I'm saying, you know, there's no evidence showing that there are negative impacts of sunscreen use at this time, whether organic or inorganic filters. A lot of it is just correlation rather than direct causation. So I still continue to recommend all of these filters.
Yeah, I love that correlation does not equal causation. And certainly you could spend a good hour going back and forth with the patient about these various facets, endocrine disruption, systemic absorption, benzene. But at the end of the day, our goal is to make sure patients are protecting themselves. And so sometimes the path of least resistance and recommending a mineral filter, which is considered grace, it's actually the only ones that have passed through. Sometimes just even going there, I say, listen, I get all that. I get your concern. Guess what? There is a safe option. So I think it's good to be aware of these issues, know where the data is, but also know we have options if you can't necessarily turn the tide with someone who's you know, really harping on one of these. And another element of that is not just, you know, human impact, but environmental impact. And that comes up a lot as well. Dr. Al-Balak, what is your take on that and where the data is today?
Yes, I think this has gotten a lot of increased attention in recent years, and you know, for good reason. So there are certain chemical filters like oxybenzone, avobenzone, several others, which essentially are non-biodegradable. And so what happens is, you know, people put it on their body, they go swim in the ocean, it dissolves in the water and it dissolves in fats and so forth. And so this has resulted in, you know, tons of sunscreen entering into our water systems. And unfortunately, these ingredients can have some really negative effects on the marine ecosystem. So more specifically, they can lead to coral bleaching, which is essentially like the death of coral reefs. Part of that happens through ossification of the corals. And just that damage then also leads to them not being available to algae. So there's lots of beneficial algae that feed on the coral. And so there's a whole like downstream effect that happens in the marine ecosystem when you're, you know, killing off the coral reefs and then the algae. And then these ingredients are also thought as to be endocrine disruptors, as Dr. Muhammad talked about. And so these have effects on the fish and some of the other species that are living in the ocean. So they have found effects on the fish's reproductive systems, their behavior, you know, other effects on the fish as well. And so overall, when you look at the whole marine ecosystem, some of these ingredients can have these untoward effects. In some states like Hawaii, for example, they actually have banned some of these ingredients. So I think they initially in 2018 had banned oxybenzone and then I think it was octinoxate. And then they've added to that avobenzone and octyrolene. So, you know, it is something that we need to be mindful of and aware of as we want to also, you know, protect the environment over time as well.
No, thank you for sharing that. Yeah, I mean, I think we're already limited in the fact that we've had the same filters for so long, and we start cutting some of the easiest to formulate and very effective filters. You know, it does create somewhat of a scales of photo protection or benefit for, you know, safety issues in terms of, well, if we don't have these, are we able to adequately protect people? And we have options, but certainly the data needs to really be supportive of these broad stroke measures. When they are, you know, really employed in these large areas where sunscreen is going to be so hugely important to prevent all the harmful effects of UV radiation. Next slide, please. So here, I guess, is really the big question. You know, I think we've hit on some of this already. How do we recommend sunscreens to patients? You know, and I think that's a really tough question. I'm going to preface it with that because a conversation with one individual is going to be very different than with another. I mean, Dr. Muhammad, you mentioned you're taking that personalized approach, though in each of those kind of person-specific, you know, soliloquies that we share with our patients, there are some basic things that we want to make sure we're in there in terms of that lexicon, the SPF 30 or higher, F15 or higher, depending on which you prefer, broad spectrum, water resistant for 80 minutes. I like to tell patients, look for hopefully more ingredients on the back. you know, there aren't a ton of options that contain both the mineral and the organic, but there are some out there. But at the end of the day, I think the most important thing is try a couple out. And that's where I think samples are so hugely important. I know we're all in academic medicine. I'm actually fortunate enough that I can offer samples because it's really hard to tell a patient, hey, go out and buy this. And however much it costs, they use it and it makes them look not so favorable, poor cosmesis. And they're like, I just spent all this money and I hate it. And now I hate you too. And that's why I'm writing this Yelp review currently, signed your former patient. So I think having samples of different sunscreens with different composites can actually improve adherence and of course, you know, satisfaction from patients. And so I have a lot of goodie bags that I give out for that very purpose. What about you guys? Sorry, Dr. Muhammad, what is your approach?
Yeah, no, I definitely agree. And, you know, we talked about the best sunscreen is the one that you wear. And something that I really like for patients, especially if I'm recommending a tinted sunscreen, is I'll tell them to go to like one of these beauty stores like Sephora and Ulta, where they'll actually sample products for you. And so I tell them, like, you know, before you go invest in a sunscreen, which sometimes can be quite pricey, you can, you know, get a little container, try it out, make sure it looks good on your skin. And then, you know, make sure that you feel comfortable using the sunscreen before you actually invest.
Well said. Dr. Ebelak, what about your thoughts? And I know it certainly is going to be a very different conversation depending on if a patient's coming in to your center on a daily basis. Are there some common threads or what are some unique nuances that you discuss with your patients?
Yeah, so total agree with everything that you guys have said. I say all the same things to them. I mentioned the reapplication, which I talked about earlier. I talked to them about different formulations, you know, in terms of like powders versus makeups versus sprays versus lotions. And so different ways in which they can use it depending on their lifestyle. I love the whole idea that Dr. Muhammad talked about with the personalized photo protection. You know, there are now sunscreens that also have antioxidants and other ingredients in them to help protect from environmental pollutants and, you know, other things that help kind of reverse the signs of sun damage. So, you know, the market is expanding as we look at, you know, sunscreens and what's available and what's appropriate for each patient. But, you know, I think the biggest thing is, you know, once we kind of lay out the land of all of those things we've talked about, just working with them to really figure out, you know, what they like and what they'll use. And once you find that, you know, they'll be married to it. And I usually, because I can't give out samples where I'm at, just have, you know, I talk to them about different options. And similar to what Dr. Muhammad said, you know, they can try stuff out at some of the beauty stores or give sort of a tried and true list of some of the things that people, you know, in general over the years maybe have tried and liked based on, again, their skin color, their history medically of what conditions they have, et cetera, their lifestyle and so forth.
I think it's also important not to forget that, you know, sunscreen is one piece of the overall package. I really try to emphasize that you can't just rely on sunscreen. There was this really nice study not that long ago that showed that even when applying that 2 milligrams per centimeter squared, which no one does, that even if you irradiate that person's minimal erythemal dose, the amount of energy needed to cause injury, there still are sunburn cells. There's still injury. So even when using sunscreen the right way, there still is some degree of injury. So it's a composite. It's using sunscreen, protective clothing, seeking shade, which in California I know is near impossible. So I imagine you don't really bring that up too often. Hats, sunglasses, the whole shebang. I think we have to highlight that because even if someone says, I am never, ever, ever going to use sunscreen, that's unfortunate. But there are other things you can absolutely do. I've seen some folks, you know, at the pool with the full body suits. I mean, that's not necessary for me, but, you know, whatever works to limit the injury that we have so well characterized that the World Health Organization has really designated as a carcinogen, that lovely UV radiation. So I think it's, you know, the point's well made. Personalize it, get a feel what the patient's comfortable with, getting them on a routine that's consistent, but also rely beyond just sunscreen and everything else. All right, let's go to the last slide and we can kind of wrap up with some take-home messages. And actually, to begin, I'd love to give everyone the opportunity to give their final sun protective thoughts. Dr. Muhammad, why don't you start off?
Yeah, so, you know, I think that you know, this was a pretty comprehensive overview of sunscreen and why we need it. And I think we all know that, you know, sunscreen is necessary to kind of help protect against, you know, visible light and UV radiation. But, you know, it is part of a process, and we need kind of a total photo protection package for patients where they feel comfortable with how they're taking care of their skin, you know, both in context of how their sunscreen feels on their skin and the other things that they're using in terms of sunglasses, photoprotective clothing, but also that they can really get behind in terms of feeling comfortable with their health impact and the environmental impact as well.
Well said. Dr. Alblock.
Yeah, so I think so many important points have been said. I really echo and agree with everything. And I think, you know, the other thing is just telling, you know, a lot of my patients feel, when we talk about sunscreen, it feels a little burdensome. And so I really try to simplify it for them. And, you know, one thing I thought about when we were talking is that people, when they're going through their routine with me, they'll say, well, you know, I put on my moisturizer and then I put on my sunscreen. And then I explain to them that, like, most sunscreens are in a moisturizing base. Like, you can fuse those two steps into one, right? When you're using a lotion sunscreen, that can also moisturize your face. So so really figuring out how to kind of take away it feeling burdensome and just really incorporating it into one's daily lifestyle, I think has been really key to kind of get compliance and adherence for my patients.
Well said. Yeah, I think everything's been said. I think these 3 points are so integral to ensuring our patients protect themselves. And that's also something to consider when someone really pushes back about whatever measure we're reinforcing, is what is the outcome from doing nothing? You know, is there harm in not following any of these recommendations, no matter how personalized it gets? And then we know that ultraviolet radiation can cause harm. And so when some of these concerns about whether it be, you know, human impact, environmental impact, both of which need more data to really substantiate any of these claims, you could also make the argument, well, these things still are in the air, but we know how dangerous UV radiation can be to the skin. So really hitting that point home that doing nothing could be more harmful than actually doing something. But then also listening to your patient, ensuring that you understand where they're coming from, what their concerns are, and addressing them, because this is a certainly long-term relationship. Our patients are chronic patients for the most part. And this is a long-term behavior and activity that will need reinforcement. So thank you so much for both of you sharing your expertise, your time. Thank you all so much for joining us. In the interest of time, we're going to hold off on any questions. However, thank you for submitting your questions. We will circulate these amongst the group and find a way to get those answers out to everyone. So have a wonderful evening and stay sun protected.